This. Okay, so tonight's topic is Betty Friedan, and this is our penultimate class for the season. Next week we will have another, I think, very controversial topic. We're going to look at Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson, the seventh Rebbe of the Chabad Lubavitch movement, a fascinating individual and misunderstood in many circles, I think, a person with made a huge impact on modern society, and I think we'll have an interesting discussion in that way. But tonight, we're going to be talking a little bit about women who changed things, women who had a dramatically different view of society, and through their influence, were able to leverage phenomenal changes that my own daughters enjoy tremendously in the 21st century. And with that in mind, that's my segue to the joke, which speaks to this idea that Jews historically are politically very quiescent. You know, they try to, you know, blend into the background. They try to avoid, you know, controversy and so on. There's a passage in the in Pirkei Avot that says, you know, Hevi mispala b'shlomo shel malchus. You should pray for the welfare of the community. Pray for the welfare of the government. She'il male mora ish esrehu chaim balau. Because if were not for the fear of the government, people would swallow each other alive. So the idea is Jews should, you know, be quiet, not make trouble, things like that. So the joke goes like this: there are two Jews who are being led out to execution. And one of them starts screaming at the top of his lungs, "It's a mistake, I'm innocent, you've got the wrong guy, I demand a retrial, I demand an appeal, where's my lawyer?" And the other one says to him, "Sha, don't make trouble." That was the punchline, okay, all right, sorry. I talked to a student today from New York, Mr. Alexander, how are you doing, shout out there, who says that I'm actually very funny, which I appreciated. Mind you, I'm still grading his essays. But he says one day he would like me to turn the camera around. Don't do it, Mr. Rodriguez. He would like to turn the camera around to see how come it's so quiet back there. I think it's the microphone, but anyways. Okay, let's talk about our topic for today, Betty Friedan. And we have the clicker today, so we can go backwards and forwards, and we have the little red pointer. Her name is Betty Naomi Goldstein, born in Peoria in 1921. The E was added as kind of an affectation by her parents. That was kind of like a cool thing to do, like today when they'll put accents on words and things like that. So she later dropped the E when she was in college, but at the time she was named Betty Naomi Goldstein. Obviously a young Jewish woman, her claim to fame, and it is extensive, is two primary achievements. One is a very important book with huge influence in America and throughout the world, known as the Feminist Mystique, 1963, a rather searing critique, not only of the sort of American middle class ideal of femininity, but in many ways, really the entire patriarchal system from the ancient world in the West to the 20th century. A book that was a landmark critique of what people thought about themselves, particularly women, and really launched a new era, ERA, so to speak, of women's rights in America. Thank you for acknowledging that small pun. Okay. Secondly, she founded a very important organization, the National Organization for Women. She was its founder and first president, and pushed through a lot of really important legislation in this country related to women and rights. The theme for tonight's lecture is I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking about the history of feminism, because I know that for many of you in this audience, this is something that you're very well aware of, but bear in mind that there are undergraduates on the other side of the camera in particular who don't have that much familiarity with this. In fact, some really fascinating recent studies have been done, and they do it, for example, at UCLA and a few other colleges, where they'll interview incoming freshman women. That's in itself a kind of a sexist term, freshman women or fresh persons. And they'll ask them, you know, what do they think about feminism? And a large majority of young women today have a negative impression of the word and the concept feminism. They regard feminists as being shrill and manly and all kinds of things that they don't necessarily want to adopt. But at the same time, if they ask those same young women, you know, how do you feel about things like equal pay for equal work, and how do you feel about, you know, daycare subsidy, and all of a sudden they become huge feminists, you know. So in other words, there's a gap between what young women today realize about what their mothers and grandmothers have achieved. They reject the label, but they don't understand really the content that goes behind that label. So the topic for tonight is, I'd like to speak a little bit about the history of feminism coming up to the middle half of the coming up to the middle of the 20th century, and then I would like to look at Betty Friedan's life in particular, although not in great detail, but we'll survey some of the most important elements of her life. And then I'd like to spend the last 15-20 minutes speaking about the development of Jewish feminism in the 1960s and onwards, and its implications for Jewish women today. So that is the plan. Here's the clicker, it works now. Bang. So, feminism, or as more properly known in the 18th century, was the women's question. What was the women's question? Really, it was the men's question. It was like, what are we going to do with women? It is ironically pretty much contemporaneous with the Jewish question. And in a lot, there's some eerie parallels between women's quest for legal rights, social rights, and so on, and Jews' quest for legal, social rights, and so on, for emancipation. Quite often, not only do they run in parallel, they intersected, as we have in the 20th century, where so many of the leading feminists were, in fact, the Jewish women at the same time. But for much of it, these are two similar causes that run simultaneously. If you recall, when we talked about Shlomo Michoels a few weeks ago in the lecture on the Soviet Union, for example, the Soviet Union established a section of the Communist Party for Jews at the same time that they established a section of the Communist Party for women, and they abandoned them both at the same year as well. So these two ideas, these are like subgroups, an interesting kind of minority within the either a physical minority or a legal minority, have a lot of things in common. It really begins with the French Revolution in 1789. Like, so many things changed with that very important revolution, which occurred, of course, in the heart of Europe, transforming a major monarchy that had lasted since who knows when into a democracy overnight. And they totally rewrote the rules on everything, including how to measure things, you know, instituting the metric system, how to measure time. They moved to a decimal system with 10 months of the year, a 10-day week, which made things really crazy for Jews who are trying to observe one day in seven on Shabbat. And of course, in terms of the great human experiment, the French came up with the very important phrase, liberté, égalité, fraternité, liberty, equality, and brotherhood for all. And they were thinking everybody except for women and Jews, of course. Jews didn't get emancipated until 2 years later, when a lot of the Sephardic Jews in Bordeaux said, hey, what about us? We're French as well. And women were not considered. In fact, Marie Guz, who was an important thinker of the time, she suggested perhaps we should amend the current document, the very famous not exactly a constitution, but a clarion call of the French Revolution, the rights of man and citizen. And she wanted to have a change to read, or an additional version, the rights of woman and citizen. The word citizen in French, of course, is declined, either masculine or feminine. And she wanted to say, hey, listen, you know, your document here is beautiful, but it's intrinsically sexist. What about women? And the French leaders at the time said, no. We only meant men. And so that project languished. And so the question was, you know, why were women so excluded at the time? The women's question said, why should we be excluded? Were they excluded on the basis of religion? Obviously not, because they were also French Catholics. By custom, I mean, men's and women's, it was one culture. Or obviously it was only because of biology. And this was the beginning of a couple of centuries of struggle for women to achieve equal rights in Europe. Women had a lot to do with changing things around during the period of the Enlightenment. This is a photograph, or a portrait, excuse me, of Rahel von Hagen. You recall we spoke about her as well a few weeks ago. She was a very important Jewish woman who ran a salon. The word salon in French means living room. And basically, she and hundreds of Jewish women like her, middle class, upper middle class Jewish women, who are basically the backbone of feminism up until the last quarter of the 20th century, would invite guests to her home, typically wealthy people who could become patrons of people who are practicing the arts, philosophers, musicians, artists, and so on. And it was in these salons a lot of the new and exciting ideas, politically and socially, that would later develop in Europe were discussed and brought to fruition. And one of the very important and frequent discussions was on, you know, what to do with women. Should women always be in a secondary status vis-a-vis men? Let me give you a few examples of that. If you look at the Napoleonic Code, here you can see a really great picture of Napoleon pointing the way over the Alps in one of his many escapades. Not someone, I think, with an overly large view of himself from this rather heroic picture. But looking at this law code from 1804, there's a lot of really incredible things that, you know, blow us away by our standards. For example, women needed a husband's permission to attend university, to live apart from their husband, or to work outside the home. All these things, you had to have a written permission from your husband to do such things. This, of course, has changed dramatically. Like, for example, I know that when I go shopping for my wife and she gives me a shopping list, I basically have to hold on to that shopping list for about 6 months, because invariably there will be some question. I said the Heinz ketchup. What are you doing buying the generic, right? I have to make sure. I'm going to edit that part out when I do it for the... No, but I mean, okay, I tried to make a joke. It wasn't very funny. Okay, women... Thank you very much. Women may own property, but... First of everything, women may own property, but only since 1870 in Britain. Before 1870, women had no legal rights to have title to any property. Germany, a little bit later, 1900, and France, home of the revolution itself, did not give women the right to own property until 1907. Rather amazing. Huge double standards everywhere you look. For example, in the case of adultery, God forbid, women would receive a punishment of imprisonment for 2 years for adultery, and men would receive a fine. And even the circumstances under which they would receive the fine were exceptional. For example, if a man brought his mistress to the bridal home rather than seeing her at some Motel 6 or something like that. So really tremendous inequalities between men and women in the view of punishment. And one of the most infamous ones, which actually I could not track down, so I'm not positive that this is associated with the Napoleonic Code per se, but forgive me if I have it wrong. One of my students, hopefully you'll fact check this and make a little comment on the video. The so-called rule of thumb. Are you familiar with this phrase, the rule of thumb? Yeah. Which means basically a rough estimate, right? So apparently the rule of thumb comes from the Napoleonic Code that a husband may only be charged with the crime of beating his wife if he used a stick that was larger than the diameter of his thumb. Smaller than diameter of thumb, that's just a regular kind of household dispute, a domestic dispute. Larger than the thumb, then that was a crime already. Hence the rule of thumb. And you get a sense of the many, many areas in which women faced phenomenal legal disabilities. Moving into the Industrial Revolution, which is also kicking off at about this time, we have it really starting in the last quarter of the 18th century and then proceeding with rapidity through the 19th century. Women are suddenly seen as a great source of labor, which has, it's a double-edged sword. On the one hand, it gave women a lot of gainful employment, which previously they would not necessarily have had outside of the family farm or business. Suddenly, they could become independent wage earners on their own. But at the same time, it's a widespread assumption that women should receive less wages than a man. And women and children were exploited with incredibly low wages, far below the already exploitative wages that men would receive. And this is a phenomenon that, of course, persists to the present day. In 2012, the figure in the United States of America was that women receive approximately 77 cents on the dollar for pay of equal work when compared to men. This is something that even my undergraduates are kind of surprised with, but it's true. A man and a woman doing the same job in America, the woman is likely to be paid, you know, 3/4 what the man gets for the same job. Women also had the traditional double burden during the Industrial Revolution and moving on into the 20th and 21st centuries, where they would be sent to work and they would earn some capital for the home, but when they got home, they would be expected to have the same responsibilities they did were they, so to speak, traditional stay-at-home women. Of course, there is no really such a thing as the traditional stay-at-home woman. That's sort of like a kind of a chimera or a fantasy of 1950s Leave It to Beaver era, but nevertheless, women would be expected to go out of the home to work for a wage and then come home and take care of children, food preparation, laundry, and so on. So women really had, in many ways, a very, very difficult time through the Industrial Revolution. There's much more to say about this. We have to go on. So the feminist periodization is usually divided between first wave and second wave feminism. The second wave is the one that's associated specifically with Betty Friedan and her activity. The first wave is older. It goes back to really the late 19th century in particular, and it's very, very prominent in America, and it's concerned primarily with the addressing of these huge inequalities, particularly in legal terms. The most significant of these efforts of first wave feminists was the so-called suffragette movement. Suffragette, of course, means a female voter, immortalized in a somewhat patriarchal way by the Mary Poppins movie, which I'm sure you've all seen, and my daughter Aliza was prominent in just recently. Of course, did they make any big... I wonder how they did the suffragette scene in the production. Of course, men aren't allowed to go to the production, and so I have no idea how it was handled, but Aliza, how did they handle that? Like, I really should get the video for y'all to see. Are you familiar with the scene? This slightly ditzy woman, the woman of the house, she's slightly ditzy, and she comes in wearing all her petticoats and things like that, and these silly little umbrellas, and she's wearing like this you know, sash, which says something like votes for women or something, and she gets all the kids and the maid up into a dance celebrating how women get the right to vote. But the impression you get in the film is that this is the last person you want to give a vote to, because she's not intelligent enough to make any reasonable decisions. And so it's a very condescending kind of approach to the whole suffragette question. They're making fun of women seeking the right to vote. Is that how they handled it in the production? Right. So, well, as they say in Yiddish, plus ça change, plus c'est la même chose. Okay, so nevertheless, I'm sorry, Joe, do you want to say something?
First day,
all right. The more it changes, the more it stays the same. The suffragette movement, of course, was successful in the end, and in 1920, the 19th Amendment was passed, which formally gave women the right to vote in the United States, a major victory for this first wave. But as we see in so many areas, the right to vote is hardly the end of, it's hardly, well, I guess it's the end of the beginning, and that's it. Okay, so going now to Betty Friedan. Any questions before we go to Betty Friedan? Yes, please.
I have to interject on a political note. The Republicans voted against equal pay for women in 2012.
You know, I have to be very careful what I say in shul about politics, but I'll tell my wife, and she'll be very pleased that you brought that up. Okay. So Hurley Youth. Okay, so she was the eldest child. There were three children in the family of Harry and Miriam Goldstein. Harry was a first-generation immigrant from, I believe it was Russia, the Russian Empire. He had a very thick accent that he never lost. But he pulled himself up by his bootstraps, established a small jewelry store, which ended up becoming quite profitable. He married Miriam, who was a first-generation American without an accent, much younger than he. Her parents disapproved of the match, but it went ahead anyway. And he brought up his wife and family in a very solid upper-middle-class family in Peoria. Later in her memoirs, the young Betty spoke about how she had really no idea what it was like for people off the bluff. The bluff was the area looking over Peoria. She always had servants and so on, and she had no idea of what it was like for people, so to speak, on the other side of the tracks. Like many firstborn, she was quite precocious, demonstrated a very high level intelligence, and particularly in the humanities. She was a very strong writer, and throughout her primary and secondary school years, she spent a lot of time in literary efforts, establishing school newspapers and things like that, and everyone thought that she would succeed. Her mother, Miriam, had wanted to go to Smith College, a very prestigious all-women's college, but her father had forbidden it, and so there was no question in her mind that her daughter, Betty, and of course her sister after her, would also go to Smith. And it was at Smith that she began to really explore a lot of new ideas. One of those areas of thought that she was exposed to was the thought of Karl Marx, who we should really spend an entire lecture speaking about in perhaps next season, God willing. Marx, of course, the founder of what would be called today the communist movement, had a lot to say about discrimination against women. He felt that marriage was a form of theft. He felt that the idea of possessing a woman as a form of chattel was essentially a type of economic exploitation in which a man would ensure that the progeny were in fact his own in exchange for, you know, the goods and services that go with the secure home. And a woman, on the other hand, would essentially be prostituting herself in order to exchange goods and services of a sexual nature in order to have the security of a home. Amazingly, Marx was happily married. He was never dumped by his wife, Jenny von Westphalen, even though he wrote all, maybe she couldn't understand German, I don't know. But at any rate, Marx felt that, you know, the discrimination against women was a very, very fundamental thing that was well inbred in Western society, and he wished to uproot it entirely. There were some significant experiments on this, including in Israel, but that's beyond our topic for today. One of the more influential works of the Marxist thought was a rather amazing book by a guy named Chernyshevsky called Što djelat, What is to be done? So influential that, among others, Lenin even borrowed that title for his most influential pamphlet on politics, which was essentially a total revision of society in every aspect. And in Chernyshevsky's What is to be Done, which is an amazing novel and really worth reading, although it's just mind-boggling, it has this one character in it who has decided, like Marx argued, to completely reevaluate himself and to question every social norm. So, for example, you know, he wants to toughen himself up, to be able to be prepared. He wants to make his body as strong as it physically could be and not rely on the disabilities that society imposes on him. So he sleeps regularly on a bed of nails rather than on a mattress. He believes that his digestive system has become corrupted by the dainty foods that he ate as an upper middle class person, so he eats ground glass. All kinds of crazy things like this. And of course, he practices free love because he believes that the whole institution of marriage that we have developed is contrary to the best development of human potential. So these are the kinds of ideas that she was encountering in the 1950s. This was before the House Un-American Activities Committee really began to give communism and socialism a very bad name. She would ride her way through a lot of this, by the way. She did exceedingly well at Smith College, developing a very important newspaper there, And ultimately, she graduated summa cum laude in psychology, and she went to Berkeley, California, where there are no socialists or communists whatsoever. Right? That's a joke, of course, right? So, and she was even more influenced when she was out west, although ultimately she did not end up completing her PhD in psychology. Also, kind of ironically, it's interesting when you read the biographies of her, this is a period of time when therapy was kind of booming, almost faddish in its nature, and she spent most of her life in therapy, and it was like really kind of something that everybody did. She was in therapy, her husband was in therapy, all her friends were in therapy. Even when she could barely rub two nickels together, she was still spending it on therapy. It was just, it was like drug use in the 1960s was the kind of thing that people did in big ways. She moved eventually back to New York, where she combined her literary talents with her newfound Marxist ideology, and she wrote for trade union papers such as the Union of Electrical Workers, essentially writing articles in a leftist vein, trying to promote change for blue-collar working-class individuals. It was at this time that she met Carl Friedman, a veteran who just returned from World War II and was somewhat lost, looking at different possibilities in his life. He had just come off of a bad relationship, or of a failed relationship, where his girlfriend from before the war had moved out with another man, and he met Betty, and they had a whirlwind relationship that ended in a very quick marriage and production of three children. He dropped two letters from his name. Did I get that right? Yes, two letters from his name. His name is actually Friedman. He changed it to Friedan. Betty liked it very much. As one biographer quipped, he had an extremely poor relationship with his own parents, and by dropping the two letters, he was dropping both the ma and the man from his name. That seems a little bit far-fetched, but it's kind of cute and worth repeating. Their marriage was extremely stormy. People who went to their home often found them getting into, you know, really serious knockdown, drag-out fights. One particularly memorable one involved Betty, who was actually something of a gourmet cook, and she brought out to a whole bunch of assembled guests this beautiful fish dish, and Carl apparently picked up the entire platter and threw it against the wall. Betty went and picked the fish up off the floor and off the wall, cleaned them up, put them back on the platter, and went back to serving her guests. They had a very stormy marriage. A lot of controversy. At one point, she mentioned in her memoirs that Carl beat her. Carl, you know, really objected to this characterization, and what she meant, and she took it back in an interview, was that, no, we used to fight a lot, and Carl was a lot bigger than me. That's all it was. So it wasn't like wife abuse, but it was kind of like a mutual give and take, in which he had a height and weight advantage over her, so to speak. At any rate, not a model kind of marriage by any terms. Now, while she was working for the Union of Electrical Workers, she had to give up her job in 1952 when there were some cutbacks. And as was typical then, it was just simply understood that when a woman became pregnant, she would lose her job. That was just, it was just understood that there was no such thing as maternity leave. There was some dispute over whether or not this was in fact the case, that there was a pregnancy that terminated her employment, but she did in fact lose her job at that time, and she began writing as a freelancer primarily for women's magazines, Red Book and Ladies Home Companion and things like that. And then a very important thing happened to her in 1957 when the 15th anniversary reunion of her college was being held, and she decided she would write an article on what people have been doing over the last 15 years. And this was a turning point in her life because, on the one hand, she had a lot of mixed feelings about what had happened to her own life. When she left Smith College, she was really a rising star. She was the editor of a very successful newspaper, school newspaper. She had founded a very important school news magazine called Tide. She was heading out with a full scholarship to Berkeley to study psychology. And now here it was 15 years later. She was barely employed writing freelance. Her marriage was nothing really exciting. She was living in extremely dire circumstances. They actually had to move out of one house because the rent was great, but the heating bills were overwhelming. And she was thinking, wait, you know, like, have I really accomplished what I was supposed to accomplish in 15 years? And as she began interviewing women from Smith who were also reflecting on the last 15 years, she began to identify that her feeling was not unique, that many women had the same feeling, and she called it the problem that has no name. And what it's really referring to is this idea of women feeling, is this all there is? Wasn't there supposed to be something so much more wonderful and amazing 15 years later? I really should use more technology. Menachem was saying I use so much of it. But are you familiar with the band called the Talking Heads? There's a great song on the album 77 where a guy wakes up and he says, wait, this is not my beautiful house. This is not my beautiful wife. How did I get here? Right? It's kind of that moment of, wait a second, not working the way I thought it would. So this ended up becoming transformed. This was transformed later into a book that was an immediate bestseller called The Feminine Mystique. And the title in itself is sort of tongue-in-cheek. It means, you know, it refers to this kind of like miasma, smoke and mirrors kind of story, propaganda that women are fed to keep them happy, when in reality, the society is set up to disappoint them. In other words, you know, they're pushed forward, get a college education in which your terminal degree will be MRS. And we don't really expect you to make any greater contribution than perhaps know how to make great blueberry muffins or something. And like these highly intelligent women with a lot of, you know, dynamism and a lot of will and drive and creativity suddenly find that once they enter into matrimony, all of that stops. And the intellectual challenges that they had with the new advantages with higher education and so on just end, and now they're concerned with doing their children's third grade homework and things like that, and they're left wondering, is this all? Is this what's supposed to happen at this point? They feel trapped as housewives. And she didn't just leave it there. She said, well, if this is the case, then obviously we have to change socially and politically. And this began a whole new wave of feminism, so-called second wave feminism, because it went away from the obvious legal disabilities of, you know, are women allowed to work or not? Should women receive the same pay as men? And obviously that's something that we're still working on. But more to a social question of like, you know, what do we expect from our daughters? And do we really give them the tools to achieve what we say they can achieve? And this was the type of feminism that was extremely important for the last half of the century. She also founded a political arm that backed up these statements. She didn't just write a book and then walk away. She was an extremely influential activist, a very sharp orator, and a powerful force in this burgeoning feminist movement. She formed the National Organization for Women. There are a lot of kind of ironies in this that she was nevertheless still sensitive to her class. And one, I think, telling example, when they had one early meeting and there was a secretary there who was charged with cleaning up afterwards, and one of the other organizers said to Betty, okay, well, why don't we help the secretary clean up? And she says, I don't wash cups, right? Because she had a sense of herself and her position and so on, and she could be brusque with other women. She had a lot of difficult relationships with other feminist leaders as well, who respected her for her drive and for her intelligence, but not necessarily for her miscongeniality kind of personality, so to speak. But the National Organization for Women, extremely important organization, primarily petitioned for things like civil rights for women, like equal pay, as we've addressed. Also, more controversially, they addressed the issue of reproductive control. This was, of course, before the landmark 1972 Roe v. Wade decision, in which abortion was still illegal or highly inconvenient, very difficult for women to legally access abortion. And also related to second wave feminism, perhaps we'll discuss in a second, it was definitely tilted towards women of means. It was far more difficult for lower socioeconomic women, women lower on the socioeconomic channel, ladder, to receive doctors' permissions to receive an abortion, whereas for white middle-class women, they had much greater access. These are the kinds of issues the National Organization for Women worked for on a daily basis with various marches, some of them as many as 50,000 attendees and so on. Okay, I'd like to pause at this point. We'll come back to her life at the end of the lecture, but I'd like to, because this is, after all, a lecture in Jewish history, what does this have to do with Jews? And I think there's some fascinating things to talk about here, but I'll take a sip of my coffee and ask if anyone has any questions to this point. Please.
Well, I know probably the expression, the glass ceiling,
yeah,
came about in the late 80s, early 90s, but were they dealing with that issue as well? I grew up, I was in college at this time, but I don't remember anything such as that.
That's an excellent question. I have a feeling Judith can answer it.
The glass ceiling actually came into being in the 70s.
It did.
Uh-huh.
And when women were moving into and getting degrees in your major universities, in schools like Wharton School of Finance and what have you, and the MBAs at Harvard opened up in business and finance to women as well. So the glass ceiling was there at that time. One of the interesting things about the vote for women was that it came at a period of time just as the Democrats were about to lose their prominence in Congress, and they realized that women were an ideal source of voters who would gravitate towards the Democratic Party.
Yeah, interesting.
And it has held true. Interestingly enough, and I know you'll get to it, is the first wave of feminism and Judaism is very much demonstrated in the number of women in the union organization.
Ah, good example. I'm glad. I wasn't even planning on talking about that, but that's really important. Yeah, women, especially socialist Jewish women. Yeah, definitely. Triangle shirtwaist factories and things like that. Definitely. Okay, Ms. Abramson, then we're going to move on. And by the way, just for the camera, in case you couldn't hear in the back, there's a discussion about something called the glass ceiling, which for you undergraduates under the age of 25 is this phenomenon where women can get jobs in industries, but then they find that they can't get promoted past a certain point. There's a glass ceiling. Nobody else can see it, but it's there. They can't get past it to become CEOs, things like that. Ms. Abramson. Look how prescient, right? She was going to ask, what was the glass ceiling, right? That's what it means. That, you know, you have to realize when you're speaking to young people, they're so stupid. I shouldn't say that. No, I'm joking. They're not so stupid. They're just, they don't know so many things that we take for granted. I know. Either that or I'm getting smarter as I get older. I don't know. Probably. Let's go on. I'm going to have to edit this. You know, we only have one more lecture and then I'm done for the summer. Okay. Let's talk about feminism and Judaism, and I'm going to get it when I get home. First, the thing about my wife and then this. Okay. So now Judaism, it's probably the only thing it has in common right now is the last three letters, and that's it, because Judaism is a highly gendered culture. I mean, we could spend a lot of time ticking off all the various differences between men and women, particularly in traditional Judaism, which is relevant for our discussion today, especially 18th century. The life cycle celebrations comparing men and women are completely different. You look at the what my grandmother Leah Shalom used to call the hoo-ha factor. Like the hoo-ha's associated with the birth of a boy, and then, you know, the bris milah, and then the bar mitzvah, and all that stuff, they vastly outdistance that what you do for a young woman. The wedding is the big deal, but the wedding is also involves a man as well. And there are, you know, we're in a shul right now where there's a mechitza, where there is a distinction between where women pray and where men pray, which many would understand as a negative distinction as well. Obviously, Orthodox Jews do not find it as a negative, but that's not our topic for today. Rights and privileges, however, there are some real serious, very important areas in which women do not have, in traditional Judaism, the same rights and privileges as men. There are, obviously, I can say this is not an apologetic, that there are areas in which women have greater power than men, but they are much fewer and smaller than the areas in which men generally have greater power than women. Again, it's not within the scope of our one-hour lecture to go into these. The point I'm trying to get across, though, is that Judaism is gendered, that men and women are treated differently. When they're treated well, they're treated equally, but it's very easy for this system to degenerate into a treatment of inequality that is also disadvantageous for the woman. Furthermore, much of Jewish culture in this gendered atmosphere emphasizes the role of women in the private sphere. As we say in Tehillim and Psalms, Kol kvuda bat melech pnima, all the glory of the princess is within, meaning within the private sphere, protected, not necessarily broadcasting to the outside world and so on. This is something that is expected of the male to go out and to, you know, kill the mastodon and drag it home, those kinds of things. And although there are very significant exceptions to that, and I often like to point out the passage in Proverbs that's read every Friday night, Eshet Chayil, in which this so-called woman of valor, really a better translation would be the warrior woman. Chayal means a soldier in modern Hebrew, the soldier woman. You know, the descriptions of her are that she is, you know, buying real estate, she's into commerce, she's got ships going here and there, she's an employer with lots of staff working under her, so she's certainly not a retiring kind of Mrs. Cleaver baking cookies, but nevertheless, there is this general thrust in Jewish culture that, you know, women's place is in the home, so to speak, that they're in private domain, whereas men tend to be in the public domain, which is definitely not in keeping with a lot of the values that we've seen in the concept of feminism. At the same time, Judaism has a lot of really strong female role models from the biblical period and onward, even though numerically, no question, we've got a lot more men acting in Jewish history, or at least visible actors in Jewish history. We have some very strong foremothers who quite often completely trump their husbands. Sarah over Abraham, Rachel over Yaakov, and so on and so forth. So there's definitely a lot of strong-willed women with a sense of purpose who are frequently more correct than their husbands, and they are vindicated in the Jewish tradition. So we have kind of a mixed bag trying to analyze, you know, how would Judaism mesh with this new ideology of feminism? Jewish feminism is born primarily in the late 1960s. Up until this point, you know, feminism, even though it was often practiced by Jews, a lot of Jewish women were leaders in feminism, there was no real synthesis of Judaism and feminism until the last half of the 20th century. There are a few reasons why things begin to gel at that time. One is the fact that there are a lot of really important female Jewish leaders of the feminist movement, including Friedan and Gloria Steinem and others who are like at the forefront of the movement. And so it's very easy for young Jewish women to look to them and say, wow, you know, they're Jews and they're doing this. Perhaps I should do something too, and I should connect it to my Judaism. But one factor that I think deserves a lot more analysis, you only see it poking up here and there, maybe someone should do a good dissertation on it sometime, the tremendous change in Jewish self-image after the Six-Day War. The war of 1967, in which it was painfully evident to all kinds of viewers of world politics, that Israel was this beautiful and brand new experiment, only launched less than 20 years earlier, was going to be completely obliterated by its Arab enemies, that it was driving Israel into the sea. When Uthant removed the troops from the Sinai, the United Nations troops, and Nasser was about to advance, and then with a stunning preemptive strike and a victory after only 6 days, not only had Israel survived, but it had expanded its boundaries tremendously, conquering the entire Sinai Peninsula, the West Bank, the Gaza Strip, and the Golan Heights. So at that time, a lot of Jewish youth who had been kind of laboring under the numerous clauses, the quota system in colleges, and trying to keep their heads down, shot, don't make trouble kind of attitude. And they were getting a little bit nervous about other ethnic groups beginning to kind of feel their identities. The Black Panther movement is beginning to rise at this point. And you know, African Americans are able to express their identity. After 67, a lot of young Jews said, you know, we should be proud of our Judaism too. We should be less afraid of being out there with our Judaism, and we should explore this thing that even our parents maybe have tried to, suppress. And our parents have tried to say, don't be too religious, trying to get us to Americanize. So there is a surge in general of Jewish consciousness after 1967, which has all kinds of implications. We'll speak a little bit about it next week when we look at Rabbi Schneerson's life, because this is really the major beginning of the Teshuva movement that creates organizations like Esh HaTorah or Sameach. The entire network of Chabad houses really gets a huge spike after this point. And so, especially young women who are motivated by feminism also get a surge of Jewish pride and begin to see ways in which these two movements can come together. There's a lot more development of college-based Jewish feminist groups where women who really apply to both designations are getting together to discuss the ways in which they can create a form of feminism. The population base is ideal for this because Jewish women tend to be highly urbanized and highly educated, involved in college life, which is where a lot of these intellectual movements get a lot of traction. And later there will be a negative push towards these things as well, because feminism tends to become associated with other leftist causes, which for the most part tend to ally themselves with the Arab world and the Palestinian Liberation Organization as well. And early Jewish feminists began, and many of them quote the same kind of experience, that they'll go to feminist gatherings and they will be ostracized because of their pro-Zionist position. That they can be feminists, but it's felt to be out of step with the support for Yasser Arafat. Sylvia Barak Fishman, whose work I'm going to feature in the next slide or so, she quotes one feminist leader, unfortunately she doesn't provide the name, who went to one of these conferences in the 1970s, and one of the other delegates there said to her, "Oh, Denmark is such a beautiful place, but the problem is there in the summer it's overrun by Germans." And I tell you, the Germans, they're just terrible, but at least they did one thing right. They got rid of all the Jews. And when the interlocutor heard this, and she kind of like made it a splutter of disagreement, the woman said, "Oh, I'm so sorry, I didn't mean to offend you. Are you German?" Right? She worried that she offended a German, not worried that she offended a Jew. All right, so the anti-Semitism and anti-Zionism of the feminist movement, prominent in many feminist thinkers, began to push. Whoops, oh my gosh, I lost my clicker. Fell apart here. The anti-Semitism began to drive many of these women further into Judaism rather than into the arms of feminist ideology. I hope I can get this to work. Let's see. Yeah, wow. First. So this is, and I thank Susan for giving me this great article by Adrienne Rich, a very important article written in the 1970s about a woman who felt split at the root. Was she fundamentally a feminist, or was she fundamentally a Jew? These two areas, and it's more complicated if you look at her entire essay, but to which allegiance does she owe first? To her people or to her gender? And this will actually be the harbinger of third wave feminism, which deals a lot more with the questions of ethnicity, women of color who are feminists, because up until now, a lot of second wave feminism was really dominated by white middle class women. And there are a lot of black women who are saying, you know, you don't understand the kind of issues that we have to deal with, and so on. So Sylvia Barrack Fishman, who is one of my favorite writers on topics of this nature, she wrote a great book called A Breath of Life, Feminism in the American Jewish Community, which I'm going to use a couple of statistics for in a second. She writes that altogether, this combination of Judaism and feminism has, on the one hand, a potentially corrosive element, because, you know, Jews, after all, we're a minority. We're especially sensitive to issues like intermarriage, issues like low birth rate, and so on. And there's some areas of feminist thought that definitely have an impact on those areas. And at the same time, though, it has a complex potential, but potentially fertile union as well. And I hope to explore some of those ideas in just a moment. So I think one of the most exciting areas of Jewish feminism, which really begins kind of like well behind the front lines of feminist thinkers. It really begins in Poland in the first two decades of the 20th century, the beginning of formal education for Jewish women, which is a remarkably new phenomenon. Formal, organized education for Jewish women is something that really begins with the Beis Yaakov movement in Poland in the 1910s. Sarah Schinnerer is the founder of this movement, and if you're interested, go on the web and you'll see the lecture that I gave on her movement. It's incredibly important. It eventually leads to something that really hasn't happened since biblical times, where you have women who are equally literate to men and in many ways equally qualified to work with Judaic texts to an unprecedented level. There are, even in the, of course, the Reform movement, the Conservative movement have already ordained these women as rabbis. There's a certain amount of controversy over the ordination of women as rabbis in the Orthodox world. But even within the most right-wing Orthodox world, you do have this phenomenon that is only gaining steam in Israel, the so-called Yoatzei Halakha, halakhic advisors, where women highly trained in Jewish law will essentially act as lawyers and advocates for other women in legal systems that essentially attempts to kind of level the playing field for them there. Let's look at some statistics. Okay, check out this chart. This is a chart that makes me very happy. This is from the 1990 National Jewish Population Survey. I'm sure if we looked at the 2000 or even the 2010 numbers, we would have even better scores. But looking at how many men and women have received more than 6 years of day school, full-time Jewish education, which is the highest level that they recorded in terms of marking Jewish education, meaning how many people could say that they went to a Jewish day school for 6 or more years. So check this out. At age 65, this is men, so you have approximately 8% of men in America in 1990 who are 65 or over spent more than 6 years in day school. That means 92% obviously did not, but that's a big look at this, the contrast with women, where you have something like 1% could actually say they spent 6 years in day school. The next kind of generational slice of the stratosphere is men and women age 45 to 64. Once again, about the same proportion of men and a slightly higher proportion of women. 25 to 44, men are not getting any more educated specifically. It's basically flat. Men's education is about the same, but women have made huge strides. And by the time you get to 1990, women aged 18 to 24 have made massive gains compared to their grandmothers in Jewish education, almost equaling men. And that's really a very, very exciting and dramatic statistic that has huge historical implications. Because in Judaism, there are three ways to get status. I think I've given you this before, but let's just see if you remember it. What are the three ways that you can achieve status in the Jewish community?
Money.
Money, right. It used to be money. Now money's not important anymore. No, just joking. Money still is important, right? If you have money, then you will be important. Okay, number two?
Education.
That's number three. Education is good. Ms. Abramson?
Family,
yichus, right? If your Zaidi was the Chafetz Chaim, or if you have all these important relatives, then like every Lithuanian Jew in the world is obviously a direct descendant of the Vilna Gaon. That's at least everyone I meet says that. So you either have money, or you have yichus, or you have learning. And the only democratic way to achieve status is through learning. And this chart means that women are getting a lot more status as a result of the power that comes with learning. You see this also in occupational status. This one isn't quite as thrilling as the last slide, but also it's basically looking at women and men in two different age groups, under 45 and over 45, in various professions. And you can see that basically these green bars are older women over 45. I mean, that's not older, but like of the older segment. And the older women tend to be well represented in clerical fields, right, which are relatively low paying, secretarial, pink collar kind of jobs, and very low representation in high status jobs. The brown bars here, though, show the representation of women in younger women, and they are much lower in clerical and really important in high status. And if you compare these to the men's bars, the red and the purple here, you see that women are also really undergoing much more dramatic change than the men. So not as quite as cool as this graph, but we see that in terms of the kind of jobs that Jewish women are holding, they're definitely making huge progress at the same time. So a lot of the kind of impact of Betty Friedan and her retinue are reflected in these slides. Now, there are many areas in which, you know, Betty Friedan would definitely be unhappy with the progress or lack thereof in modern day Jewish feminism. One of the most difficult crises that refuses to be easily answered is the so-called Aguna crisis. This refers to the situation which has become really quite exacerbated in the 20th century. According to Jewish law, only a man has the right and power to divorce his wife. A woman may not divorce her husband. In the medieval period, the Beit Din had the power to physically coerce a man to grant his wife a get or a bill of divorce. But obviously, since the French Revolution that we began our lecture with today, the Beit Din does not have the power to impose corporal punishment, sanctions on another citizen. There's not a separate country. You're not allowed to simply have, you know, they're not like mafioso who can like just, you know, order a hit on a guy if he refuses to give someone a get, his wife a get. So these new freedoms have unfortunately been abused by many men who will separate from their wives but not give them a get, either out of vengeance or because they want to perhaps coerce some money out of their wives or even custody the children, who knows what it is. And no legal remedy in Jewish law has yet been found. Many have been suggested. To date, no single remedy has been discovered which will adequately address this situation. Joe? The kosher nostra, yeah, the kosher nostra, right. That remedy is essentially medieval, and it does happen, but it happens sub rosa. Yes, please. It's huge. Absolutely. Yeah, he's just pointing out there that we could make a huge laundry list. Even if I just listed them like reading the phone book, we would not have enough time in 1 hour. Point? Okay, I'll come back to you then, okay, because I'm almost out of town here. Another issue, the Jewish birth rate. Very significant. I mean, it's very different from the Aguna crisis, but here's the problem. Jewish women, without a doubt, statistically, are the most educated ethnic group of all women in America. Jewish women are much higher educated per capita than non-Jewish women. But, well-known phenomenon, higher education, correlates with a lower birth rate. Obviously, women, you know, spend time in college longer, they delay marriage, they delay childbirth, you know, and all of a sudden, they have less children overall. The replacement rate is approximately 2.1, and Jewish women, on average in America, have 1.1 children per family, which is basically like a child and a small poodle. So we have a very significant issue. There is clearly a big distinction between the Orthodox world, which has a much higher birth rate, but nevertheless, on the whole, American Jews are not replacing themselves. And one factor, we're not going to lay all of this on education, but one factor is that as women get more educated, that also has an impact on the birth rate. Yes, sir?
You answered my question.
Oh, okay, very good. And a third issue, very significant and perhaps not as well known, is that Jewish women for centuries have constituted the bulk of the volunteer base of the Jewish community, the kehillah. That, you know, okay, maybe women were not expected to bring home the same kind of paycheck as their husband, but it was known that women would, of course, volunteer for all kinds of organizations in the community. I mean, my mother was always active in all kinds of organizations, but I don't know too many women my generation who are, and I certainly don't know many my daughter's generation who are. And that's a huge cost to the community that goes unrecorded. As women get jobs, they're bringing capital into the family, but the community as a whole loses this extremely important source of communal support. So that's something that could really change our society as well. So finally, there's some really fascinating things that have been written by scholars like Lynn Davidman, Renee Kaufman, on the phenomenon of female returnees to Judaism, the so-called Ba'alot Tshuva. These are women who come from secular backgrounds, often very feminist in orientation. They begin to explore their Jewish roots, and all of a sudden they end up becoming highly observant, often going into extreme Hasidic movements and so on, and adopting a lot of the attitudes that many of their feminist sisters would find, you know, completely contradictory to the values that they espoused when they were in a secular mode. But ultimately, you know, the feminist movement is kind of like a doorway for many young women into the values of Judaism, and once they're in Judaism, they don't leave it alone. They bring those values in and in fact transform Judaism from within. Another topic that, yeah, I'd really like to study someday, but it would probably involve a lot of research, is how this massive teshuva phenomenon, according to some estimates as many as 250,000 Jews in America alone, has actually affected the Orthodox world. One small story and then I'll go to the last slide. I remember when I was studying in a kollel on the east side of Manhattan, and every morning after the morning prayers, they had this delicious breakfast. It was so phenomenal. And they had this one whitefish salad that, you know, it was incredible. I had to believe it came from, you know, Gan Eden or something. And so I said to the Rosh Yeshiva, I said, how do you get this whitefish salad? It's incredible. And he said, well, it's that guy over there. You know, he's a Baal Tshuva, and it's some guy davening. He's a Baal Tshuva, but he used to be a professional chef. And I say, so? And he says, he knows how it's supposed to taste. Yeah. Right? So he knew how it was supposed to taste when it was treif, so he was able to make it kosher. Tremendous. So that's a really interesting kind of area of exploration. How has the teshuva movement changed the way Orthodox Jews look at themselves? So, and in some ways, this is related to third wave feminism, which is associated specifically with ethnicity and feminism. So to conclude, Betty Friedan, in many ways, some of the values that she espoused were contradictory to traditional Judaism, but at the same time, her quest for women's rights have made a phenomenal change for 52% of our population, and her status as a prominent Jewish feminist leader is something that our daughters and granddaughters all benefit from. Thank you very much for your attention. Next week is the last week, and then I'll see you again in the fall, God willing.